Most of the speakers today, they are the belonging to Pramod Agrawal sir itself. Yesterday, sir has pointed out this thing after looking to the schedule. So it was a very nice, sir, to be part of here. So now I welcome and we can start the sessions.
Thank you, Ambrish. Good morning, all the dear participants. Let me start sharing my screen for the presentation. Hope my screen is visible to all of you.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
So with a brief introduction about the institute, Sant Lungwal Institute of Engineering Technology, where currently I'm heading the institute, I will start the presentation. So you can see on this particular slide, this is the administrative building of the institute. This institute is fully funded by Government of India, and we are working since 1991 with a special mandate. In addition to the conventional UGPG PhD, that is BTech, MTech, MSc and PhD program, we are running a 3 years integrated certificate and diploma program where the entry is through after 10th. So 10th pass out students are given an opportunity to enter into technical education. For this, we conduct our national level examination. And here we'll have the multi exit option as well. Either the student can join after 10th or they can join after ITI in second year ICD program. Similarly, after 2 years, they can exit with a certificate, and after 3 years, they can have the exit option with a 3 years diploma. 50% of these diploma students are admitted in second year BE. So several multiple options are available to the students to bring them in the field of technical education with their interest. So you can see on the top of the screen a few images. This is one of the student club activity where we promote our students to implement whatever they are learning in the classroom. Image 2 and 4 is indicating the lush green environment of the institute. Image 3, you can see we observe every Friday as no motor vehicle day. So we all will not use any motorbike and prefer either to walk or ride on cycle. So this is the picture shown. This is one of the board meetings scheduled on Friday. So we request all our even guests that not to use a vehicle on the Friday. So that way we are giving a message to the society, not only for a green environment, but at the same time, just a message that how responsible we as teaching fraternity are to set an example for our students. So with this, I'll come to the topic, which is the modeling and simulation of active power filter for power quality improvement. So, basically, I'll mainly talk about how we can model and simulate a particular system. In fact, you can see here the ideal and practical waveforms. So as we know that with the increased application of power electronic components in each and every field, right from few watts home charger application to megawatt of the industrial application, as well as in between the residential, commercial and industrial. Everywhere we are using a power electronic converters for converting power from one form to another. In moment we introduce application of a switch in power electronic converters, it imposes nonlinearity into the system. So this is every day increasing day by day, and this nonlinearity is causing a serious issue on the power quality. So as far as the quality is concerned, we all are familiar about the quality in one way or other way. Quality of food we are eating, quality of clothes we are wearing, quality of service we are getting, maybe for public transport or maybe for road travel, etc. But when it comes to quality of electrical power, basically even the engineers are not concerned, because we say that yes, this is not my issue, whereas the quality is a concern for each and every individual who is using power. But in fact, there a few years back, getting electricity was an issue, that if you are getting uninterrupted power, we were satisfied in that. So now in previous years, we have progressed a lot. In fact, now there was a time when there was huge power cuts, load shedding, but almost every state now is trying to generate the electricity through various means. And in fact, power cut is becoming a history now. Now the next point comes is to, once we have the availability, of course, we can talk about the quality. So what kind of load I am using, that is a constraint. But at the same time, we have to overcome these issues, that in spite of those constraints, we should be able to provide the quality power. So you can see these two pictures below. These are the practical waveforms. So load RL type of resistor and inductive load, and this is resistor and capacitive RC kind of load. Whereas ideally, we expect that both our current as well as the voltage waveform should be sinusoidal. As we, for generation, transmission and distribution, we are using the sinusoidal power. So now the question is that how we should be able to maintain the current waveform ideal, whereas practical current waveform are of these nature. So now you just see, this is a very the simple principle about the non-linearity, that in fact, a non-linear resistor or a non-linear load, you can see it does not follow the Ohm's law. With the increase in the voltage, the variation is current is non-linear. That means the shape of the voltage and current are not identical. There may be, so far we talked about the inductive loads. Say all motors are inductive in nature. So current have a lag from with respect to voltage, but it was sinusoidal. It is sinusoidal with the inductive loads. But moment we introduce the power electronic converters, the shape is non-sinusoidal. Instead of lagging angle, the variation in the shape is also there. Now this non-linear current, when flows through system impedance, you can see this is the system generation. At the generating end, we are transmitting the sinusoidal voltage. My load is non-linear. Every system, this is a transmission and distribution line, will have some system impedance. So when this distorted current flows through the transmission and distribution line, and due to these system impedances, at the receiving end voltage will also gets distorted. So if my current is distorted, it will impose a limitation, it will add distortion in the voltage as well. Whereas we are generating purely sinusoidal voltage as well as transmitting the sinusoidal voltage. So it is very necessary that we should do something so that in spite of the constraint at the this particular level as well, we should in fact inject sinusoidal current into the system. And for that, we are using the filters. So these are basically active power filters. Now we are calling them, there are two type of filters, passive filters and active filters. Passive filters are conventional filters. We'll use the concept of resonance, maybe the LC components. So in that particular cases, they are bulky in size. The size of inductor and capacitors are large, and moment we introduce L and C into the circuit, it causes the issue of resonance as well. Maybe there are sometimes series resonance, there may be a possibility of parallel resonance, which may leads to either current or voltage amplification, either current will suddenly increase or voltage will increase, that may cause the damage to the system devices. So active filters, basically we use the again power electronic converters to mitigate the issue of non-linearity in the current. So there are basically two type of filters. One is shunt active power filter, another is series type active power filter. So you can see in the shunt active power filter, this is my source, this is my non-linear load, and at the load end in shunt we connect another PWM converter which will act as a filter. So for this there are the components like this inductor and DC link capacitor. So a power converter, which is a pulse width modulated converter with a DC link capacitor, and inductor in AC side will act as a filter, and we have connected in shunt with the main line. So you can see that IS is now, is this particular point is divided into two components, load current as well as the compensator current. So shunt active power filters are mainly used to eliminate the current harmonics. It also basically compensate the reactive power as well as balance the unbalancing current. As we know, our distribution system is three phase four wire system is there, and the load is single phase. So line to neutral single phase load is there. This load we try to balance on all the three phases equally theoretically, but actual use is something different, and in fact their timings are also different. So though we will try to balance the load in all the three phases, practical current or loading will be something different, and because of that we have unbalancing, and this unbalancing will result in the significant amount of neutral current. So generally we have the concept of 3.5 core cable, isn't it? The neutral wire is considered 50% of the size of the phase currents, because we assume theoretically IA IN, the neutral current is equal to IA plus IB plus IC, and in a balanced system IA plus IB plus IC is equal to zero. So theoretically neutral current is zero, so we'll consider some unbalancing, and based on that a half size 50% of the size of the phase current neutral conductor is designed. Due to non-linearity, the neutral current sometimes increase the 50% and may leads to overheating of the neutral conductor, which may leads to insulation failure and fire hazards. So once your loads are non-linear in nature, it is very necessary to balance the current to reduce the neutral current within the limit. So shunt filters, shunt active power filter also act as a current balancing and will maintain the current in all the three phases equal, and they are installed by the customer. Whereas your series active power filter, you can see it is connected in series with the help of a transformer. So same thing again, PWM converter, instead of a DC link capacitor, here we use a DC link inductor. And through a transformer, they are connected into the line. So they are mainly used to eliminate voltage harmonics, to reduce the negative sequence voltage, to regulate the voltage on three phase system. So here you can see that we are mainly regulating the current, balancing the current. Here, the series active power filters are regulating the voltage in all the three phases. So it is mainly installed by the utilities to compensate voltage harmonics and damping harmonic propagation. Now, there are other filters, hybrid filters are there, UPQC is there. So our purpose here is that how we basically control an active power filter, and for that how we can model them using the available software tools. So you can see on this particular slide, this is the basic compensation principle of shunt active power filter. What we are doing is that this is the non-linear load which is drawing IL, which is non-linear. So you can see this is the non-linear current, diode rectifier feeding RL load, the shape of the current is something like this. Whereas we desire to draw sinusoidal current from the source. So IS should be purely sinusoidal. So what we should do is that to maintain this current sinusoidal, the difference of these two, IS minus IL must be supplied from the filter. So if we basically consider this particular point, IS is equal to IL plus IC. So that means this is nothing but a current injector, and difference of these two with in phase opposition will be injected by the filter. So that way we will maintain input current or the source current sinusoidal. Now, just to generate this particular current waveform, this is the main objective of APF control, that how we can inject desired amount of current into the system so that our source current will be sinusoidal. So this is the another pictorial view of representing the power flow for ideal compensation. Now you can see here, at the load end, if we consider a three-phase non-linear load, your load power is divided into two parts, active power as well as reactive power, PL and QL. Now this active power is again now having two components, a fundamental active power and harmonic active power. Similarly, QL will have QF, fundamental reactive power, and harmonic reactive power. Whereas if we consider at the source end, to maintain both voltage and current sinusoidal, we should only supply fundamental active power from the source. That means PS should be equal to PF and QS should be zero. So that means this is only possible if we supply PH, QF and QH from the filter. So basically, to ensure PS is equal to PF, that is equal to PL. PS is equal to PF plus PH. So PS is equal to PF or PL will be possible only if we feed these two three components, PH, QF and QH, from the active power filter. Now you can see one more component here is that there are some losses into the system. So literally all the powers are drawn from the source itself. So this source, we will draw the active fundamental power plus the loss component of the line as well as the loss component of the filter. This is the basic principle, and all the algorithms used for controlling active power filters are basically designed to feed PH, QF and QS, that is reactive power. So entire reactive power is again fundamental component plus harmonic component and harmonic active power. So you can see that P load with respect to time is equal to instantaneous power we are talking about, PF plus PR plus PH. And theoretically, if we talk about IS star, that is instantaneous current drawn from the source at a particular time, that is equal to I maximum cos phi 1 sine of omega t, where your I maximum is I 1 plus I loss. I 1 is the RMS amount of the fundamental current required by the source plus the loss component. Loss component to meet out the losses of the system. So this is the power flow requirement. Now if we come to the control strategy of APF, so for control purpose, we need to sense some parameters. And what are these parameters? So you can see the source voltage, DC link voltage, then either we sense IL, load current, source current, compensator current, either any one of them, combination of them, or all the three current. So that means a good algorithm is one which require minimum parameters to be sensed. More the number of sensors, more expensive and complex your system will be. So in fact, there are algorithms available which sense either compensator current, sometimes we'll sense load current, sometimes we'll sense the IS or the combination of either IL-IS or IS and IC. At the same time, for synchronization purpose, we'll sense the source voltage and of course the DC link voltage. And all these sensors, they have to pass through a signal conditioning circuit. So your signal conditioning circuit will require the galvanic isolation between the power circuit and control circuit. And this, the signals are need to be conditioned to the level to meet the requirement of a digital or analog controller, whatever it may be. Then in next phase, we estimate the reference current. So maybe either reference source current or reference compensator current. That is, based on sensing these parameters, we need to find out either IS star or IC star. Now let me go back here. IS star, maybe you can say this sinusoidal current is my IS star, or this IC filter current IC star. So we try to make these two current, either sinusoidal or filter current of this shape, to maintain, then only we basically feed the load current, maintaining source current sinusoidal. So there are several algorithms which some of them will calculate IS star or some of them will calculate the IC star. Then these reference current are compared with the actual currents. So actual currents you need to send either IS and IC, and then we have some control scheme to generate the firing signals for the PWM converter. So this is just a block diagram representation, and now we'll see that how we will use the signal conditioning and the estimation of the reference current. For control strategies, generally control strategies are classified into two categories, either time domain analysis or frequency domain. So in time domain, mainly what we do is that they are based on instantaneous extraction of compensating commands. At a particular instant of time, we extract the reference current. It is fast, it's easy implementation and require less computation burden. On the contrary, in frequency domain, what we do is that we basically sense various harmonic components are extracted to generate the reference command using Fourier transformation. So let us see, if we analyze the load current, which is non-linear, is using the Fourier transformation, we can represent any alternating non-sinusoidal signal in terms of a fundamental and a series of sine and co-sinusoidal signal. So that means IL is equal to I1 plus IH, fundamental component plus harmonic component. So using FFT analysis, we will extract IH, which will act as a reference compensator current. So this require cumbersome computation time. So I mean, extracting using FFT analysis, definitely they are complex in nature, and sometimes it process will take some time. You need to at least one cycle waveform, sample one cycle waveform, apply FFT in the second cycle if you are having a very fast processor. And then we are able to apply the compensation in this third cycle, which will take the effect into fourth or fifth cycle. So there will be a delay of 3 to 4 cycle in frequency domain analysis. And that is why time domain analysis, we start instantaneous compensation, which I will show you through simulation results. Now, as far as the control strategies are concerned, so APF control strategies are implemented in 3 steps, which we discussed in the previous slide: signal conditioning, estimation of compensating signal. So time domain analysis and frequency domain analysis. For time domain analysis, generally there are several algorithms are available. The most popular is instantaneous reactive power theory. We also call it PQ theory. This was in fact first researched by Professor Akagi in 1984. So first time Professor Akagi from Japan, he has proposed this concept, and his theory is named as instantaneous reactive power theory or PQ theory. And a simple way is just by regulating the DC link voltage with the help of a PI or a fuzzy controller. In frequency domain, we compensate these customer generated harmonics. Then further, the third component, generation of firing signals. Either we use the hysteresis current controller, carrier bias controller, or dead bait controller. So various methods are there for generating the firing signal. This picture, this is a configuration of APF and its control scheme in block diagram form. So you can see this is a three-phase source. We are having a three-phase non-linear load. So very commonly used three-phase non-linear load is a three-phase rectifier, simple a diode rectifier feeding RL load. Okay, this is my source inductance. You can see RS and LS. This is the source inductance and source resistance. This may be the lumped parameter of this distribution line that is represented with the help of RS and LS. Now, the filter is connected in shunt. So you can say your filter is basically, it's a three phase or single phase. In case of single phase PWM converter. In case of three-phase three-wire system, three-phase three-wire, or in three-phase four-wire system, you have to have the fourth leg of this PWM converter as well. So in a three-phase three-line system, we'll have a three-phase PWM converter with MOSFET, and IGBT is used as a self-commutating device with an anti-parallel diode. We'll have a DC link capacitor, and this PWM is connected with the main feeder with the help of a filter inductor, which is having the resistance RC and inductor LC. Ideally, these RS and RC should be zero, but we have some practical typical values. For the control scheme, as I have shown indicated earlier, either we sense the load current or filter current or source current. So in this particular case, you see, we are sensing the load currents. Okay. So in case of three phase, three wire system, we know IA plus IB plus IC is equal to zero. So IC or any second phase current is equal to minus IA plus IB. IC is equal to minus of IA plus IB. So if we sense only two currents, we are able to extract the third current. So that is how we can reduce the number of sensors. Similarly, we are sensing these source voltages. So through these current sensing and voltage sensing circuit, we sense source current, source voltage. Now, this DC link voltage is compared with a reference DC link voltage. So this is very necessary how to choose what should be this DC link voltage. So now very fundamental principle is that we are injecting current into the system. And to inject current into the system, this point potential should be higher than this point potential. So accordingly, what should be the actual potential here, based on that we decide VDC. So if VDC is a higher side, it will put more stress on these switching devices. If it is on lower side, this PWM converter, instead of injecting current into the system, will draw current from the source and we may not be able to perform the desired function. So selection of the voltage of this DC link capacitor is a very crucial aspect, which basically maintain this particular point potential higher than the grid potential or the line potential, so that we'll be able to inject the current into the system. So that is the design consideration. Now, the difference of these two will be processed in a PI controller. Then output of this PI controller is considered I1 RMS value plus I loss, which is multiplied with the unit sine current vector we are drawing from the source. And then further in hysteresis controller, these reference current IA star, IB star, IC star is compared with the actual current for the generation of the firing pulses of these six switches of the PWM converter. So you can see 1, 4, 3, 6, and 5, 2, these are the complementary pulses. 1, 4, 3, 6, and 5, 2 complementary pulses are generated from the source. Now, literally, if we talk about the impact of these compensations, so this is indicated here in this particular table with the help of some statistics. So let's see, in a particular 10 kVA system which I simulated here, my active power before compensation was 9.468, whereas after compensation it is 9.92. That means some around 0.5 kilowatt of loss component is drawn into the system. So earlier my load power was 9.5 kilowatt, which is now increased to 9.9. That is, some loss component is drawn into the system. With that particular case, there was some around 0.7 kVAR reactive power is drawn. So after compensation, you can see reactive power is zero. That means my source current is sinusoidal and exactly in phase with the source voltage. Input VA is again, see, slightly increased. Your input power earlier was 9.86 kVA, which is increased to 9.99. So that means to compensate this much of reactive power requirement, the VA has been increased, which is a very practical requirement. And to meet out this, the APF rating, basically it has to be around 30% of the system capacity. So basically you have to design a filter with almost 30% capacity of the load power with a desired amount of reactive power compensation. So obviously, if your reactive power requirement is more, your filter capacity will slightly increase. Input power factor, you can see, is almost improved to unity. Displacement power factor is again unity. And main thing, we are currently here talking about as a optional option compensation of reactive power, but the total harmonic distortion, which was around 30%, has reduced to 0.8, and generally as per IEEE standard, we have to maintain 5% total harmonic distortion in both current and voltages. So that is the main objective is achieved, that the current has become purely sinusoidal. Now, for simulation, either we can use the Simulink and SimPower system, and for that, basically we need to have the source component, load component, you have to model APF and a closed loop current control. Or maybe you can use any language programming software, say in MATLAB, we can write the code in M file, which is really a very, very complex system. But for that, you need to require the dynamic equation of this system. Whereas if we use the Simulink and SimPower system, through mathematical model, we will be able to model the various parts, source, load, APF, and the control scheme. And then we'll have some measurement parameters in terms of sensors available in the system. Now, for modeling purpose, let's see. Firstly, I require the sinusoidal source, which may be a sinusoidal or distorted. So practically, we see in the laboratory environment, we are having a purely sinusoidal voltage. But practically, where a number of type of loads are connected at a different time instance in a system, your voltage will become distorted. So we have to consider this particular aspect as well. Then how we can model the nonlinear load? We have to model a voltage source converter, some circuit elements, RLC needs to be taken, sensors and control logic. Now, we'll first start with the regulation of DC link voltage, where we are using or a fuzzy controller or a slide mode controller. In this particular method, it does not require sensing of harmonics and VAR requirement of the load. This is simple and easy to implement. And what the main objective here is that we maintain the current sinusoidal in spite of your source is unbalanced or distorted. So this is the control scheme. we sense the DC link voltage, compare with the reference value, process in a PI controller. The output is basically multiplied with the unit sine vector and then compared with the actual current, and process the hysteresis current controller to generate the firing pulses. So here we are not compensating the compensator current. We are simply sensing the source current. So only source current, neither load current nor capacitor current is being sensed here. So your sensor requirement is minimum, and that is why we'll say this is a simple method. And now you can see the simulation results here. You can see my voltages, phase A voltage, B voltage, C voltage, and deliberately I've chosen the non-sinusoidal voltages. But we are multiplying with the unit sine vector, your currents are maintained sinusoidal and exactly in phase. So your phase A voltage current is in phase with the phase A voltage, phase B current is in phase with the phase B voltage, and so on. Now, what though this method is very simple, will have some limitations. It compensates both harmonics and reactive power simultaneously. Usually, compensation of both harmonics and reactive power simultaneously is not preferred due to increased rating of the APF. So, as I had given you the statistics here, this size of APF, the APF rating is 30% to 40% of the load, and in also if a reactive wire requirement is higher, here we are using a three-phase diode rectifier. A diode rectifier with RC load or a thyristor converter with RL load, your reactive power will be much more. So with the increase in the reactive power requirement, the size of rating of the APF will be higher. So what we do is that we prefer is that the reactive wire is compensated with the help of the fixed capacitor or variable capacitor, and harmonic filtering is controlled with the help of APF. That way we can reduce the rating of the active power filter. So in this case, this is not possible. This is one of the drawback that it compensates both harmonics and reactive power simultaneously because we are not segregating them. And this is not preferred due to increased rating of the filter. Then it is aimed to maintain the mains current sinusoidal in spite of distorted or unbalanced current. So by doing so, the wire requirement is not compensated completely due to waveform difference in the voltage and current. So you can see here, my voltage is non-sinusoidal, whereas current is purely sinusoidal. So we can say the partly wire requirement is not fully satisfied. If we now come to the simulation, so we can use a three-phase diode rectifier bridge available in the library of the sim power system. We can use these elements R and L as a load, and you can choose these values accordingly to draw a desired amount of current. This is a three-phase bridge, a filter inductor, and then DC link capacitor. So these will form the power circuit of the simulation model. This picture is indicating both power circuit, that is this source, current measurement block, another the rectifier, and we have placed an inductor in series here, and the load. Whereas this is our filter inductors and DC link capacitor. Now on other component will have the currents measurement, synchronization circuit, and reference current generator. These are actual voltage and the reference voltage. They are processed in a PI controller, and then we'll have a multiplier. Then later on we'll have a pulse generator. Now we'll see each block one by one how we are modeling. So three phase, three wire, or three phase four wire source. So you can connect a single phase source, or maybe now the latest version of the MATLAB, you can directly get a three phase source, or you can connect three phase sources with a neutral point. Six devices can be connected to form a bridge, or a three phase bridge can be used with a diode or a PWM or a MOSFET or IGBT for a PWM converter. Now for synchronization, let's see what we are doing is that we have simply used a voltage sensor, V maximum sine omega t. which is basically divided by V maximum to make it sine omega t, sine omega t minus 120 degree, and then sine omega t minus 240 degree. So what we did is that VSA, VSB, VSC, line to neutral voltage is sensed, and they were divided by the peak value to generate a unit sine current vector. Then here you can see the current sensors. Basically, they are available in the library. So input current, out current, and this is the measured value. This is a PI controller, though a PI controller block is available, but I have simply basically modeled it using a different component. We'll have a gain block and an integrator block. So this is KP plus KI integration. So V ref minus V actual, and this error is processed in a PI controller. PI controller is nothing but a gain. KP is multiplied with the error. This error is multiplied with the KI gain, whatever it may be, and then integrated. That is summation, and then KP plus KI integration of the error. And then we'll put a saturation block. This saturation block will basically, you have to put it to limit the maximum current drawn from the source. For the generation of switching signal, so we use, let's say, a hysteresis band controller or a carrier controller. So in hysteresis controller, you can see we'll have a reference signal, and your actual current is measured with respect to high value as well as the low band. So this is basically hysteresis band limit is there, isn't it? So moment your current reaches to upper band, you can see here we basically switch on the lower device, the lower half of the bridge. Due to that, current starts reducing, and as soon as it reaches to a lower band value, we will basically switch off S4 and switch on S1. So that will again increase the current. So likewise, we can generate the pulses for leg A, upper and lower device. So S1 and S4, S4 is nothing but a complement of S1. Similarly, for the leg B and leg C, current pulses are generated. So your actual pulse generator for Simulink library is, we'll have the actual current and reference current, and then a relay can be used as a hysteresis controller with a band value, say maybe 0.5 ampere or 0.05 ampere or 0.1. Less is your hysteresis band, more will be your switching frequency. And then this ending block can be used to start with a controller basically. So now coming to the second method, the instantaneous reactive power theory, where the PQ theory or instantaneous reactive power theory developed by Professor Akagi. This is based on Parks transformation. What we do in Parks transformation, they basically, instead of generating the reference source current, they generate the reference compensator current. ICA star, ICB star, and ICC star. This is drawn from the reference active power and reference reactive power. So as I told you in the previous case, when we talked about the regulation of DC link voltage, in that case, we did not separated P and Q, but here we are now measuring active power, reactive power separately, and based on them, we are generating the reference compensator current. So three phase currents are basically ABC are converted into alpha beta. So you can see here P star and Q star are basically drawn from I alpha and I beta. So for this, let us see V alpha and V beta is equal to C times VA, VB, VC. These are basically the source voltages. Similarly, from IA, IB, IC, we will draw alpha and beta component of the current. So how we basically draw this three phase to two phase transformation, will sample IA, IB, IC. They are basically the load current. VA, VB, VC, this is the source current. And using this C transformation matrix, we are generating I alpha, I beta, and V alpha, V beta. Then these I alpha, I beta, V alpha, V beta are again processed with the help of some multiplier and summer block to generate the Q and IC star as well as IC beta star. That is Q and P component, which are derived in terms of reference two dimensional alpha and beta components of the ABC. Then again, we use the reverse transformation for generation of IC star, IC beta star to ICA, ICB, ICC. So what is happening here? Basically, we are converting these three phase quantities into equivalent two phase quantity for the reduced calculation purpose. But still, you can see a lot of multiplier, summer and divisions blocks are required for the generation of reference compensating current. This is actually the simulation model. You can see by source, load, this is the load inductor and resistor, sensors. This is my PWM inverter with DC link. Then we are sensing these voltages, three phase voltages. We are sensing three phase current with the help of these IABC block, which are brought here. Now these three phase source voltages and three phase load currents, ABC to alpha beta transformation is there. Then these V alpha, V beta, I beta are basically processed using these equations to generate the compensator current, ICA star, ICB star, ICC star, which is now compared with actual ICA. This is my actual filter current, ICA star, ICB star, ICC star, which is processed in again a hysteresis controller for generation of six pulses. Now in this process, what will happen in case my source voltage is distorted? Our actual compensated current ICA star, ICB star, ICC star will be distorted. So for what purpose a modified PQ theory was proposed? And there we have simply installed the low pass filter. What this low pass filter will do is that it will extract only the fundamental component and will eliminate the harmonic component. So now in spite of my source voltage is distorted, I will get distortion-free source voltage, so acting as a sine current vector. So in fact, what happened, even if my source voltage in practice is distorted, we will be able to maintain the current sinusoid. So in fact, for simulation, you can choose this AC voltage block. You can choose their amplitude, phase lag, and frequency. So you can add different phase. To make a source distorted, what I did is that I have added the fundamental component plus fifth harmonic component. So fifth harmonic component, you can choose this frequency 250, for seventh harmonic 350, and so on. So this voltage will be V1 plus V5. Again, this is 120 degree phase displacement and another 120 degree phase displacement for. So actually, in this particular case, you can see the mains voltage are assumed as an ideal source, which is not true. Therefore, affect the calculation accuracy of the compensation current. And similarly, the performance of the APF is affected. So the algorithm is mainly based on sensing the harmonics and reactive VAR of the load, which is complex and difficult to implement. But this way we are able to reduce the rating of the active filter as compared to the previous method of regulation of DC link voltage. Now you can see the simulated result here. In this particular case, you can see my source voltage is top figure, which is distorted. Now, if your source voltage are distorted, your compensated currents are also distorted. This is my filter current. So the frequency spectrum you can see here will have some distorted component as well. Now, basically, just to give you an idea, I have tried to prepare a tutorial with the simulation of a buck converter. Okay, so let me so you can see that a closed loop control of a buck converter in this particular tutorial is just basic theory part. Can you see my screen, Ambrish? Ambrish, can you see my revised screen? Not yet.
Yes, sir. Closed loop control of buck converter.
नहीं, इस मैंने एक वर्ड फाइल ओपन किया है. ओके, लेट मी स्टार्ट शेयरिंग माय स्क्रीन अदर वे. ओके, लेट मी शेयर माय स्क्रीन वंस अगेन. या, यस, नाउ यू कैन सी दिस. अ बक कन्वर्टर. In a buck converter, we'll have a DC source, we'll have a switch, a diode, an inductor and capacitor, and this is my load. Okay, so here you can see we measure the reference current, compare it with the actual and processed in a PI controller, and then we simply generate the duty cycle, which is duty cycle is simply T on divided by T. And now there are two methods, either we have the voltage control or current control. This is the actual simulation model. You can see if I wish to regulate this output voltage, what we are doing here is that we will measure the IL, which is basically compared with a constant value processed in a PI controller. And this is controlled in a repeating sequence. We'll use a rational operator to generate the pulse. So this pulse is used to control the MOSFET module which we are using. And then you can see this is the simulation results. Okay. So your output voltage and inductor current waveform. So I wish to maintain a finite amount of current. So you can see after switching, your current is maintained at a reference value which we have chosen, 2.4 ampere. So in fact, even if there is a variation in the load, we are able to maintain the constant current. Similarly, I'll show you another picture, another tutorial. This is here basically a three phase active power filter based on instantaneous reactive power theory. This tutorial I will mail you and you can circulate with all the participants. This is mainly based on the Akagi's PQ theory, and this paper was published in 1984 and then subsequently in the revised form in 1986. So you can see here the same principle which I have discussed here. We'll have a non-linear load source and filter, and this is compensation principle. Now, this is the algorithm which I have discussed, ICA star, ICB star, ICC star, which is derived from sensing the source voltage and load voltage. This was in fact the three-phase to two-phase transformation. Your ABC quantities are converted into alpha beta. Okay, so then V alpha, I alpha and V beta, I beta are used for the generic calculation of P and Q. In this case, here you can see this ILA, ILB, ILC load current, and then we'll have the source voltage phase A, phase B, phase C. They are converted ABC to alpha beta, and then we'll calculate P and Q using the above mentioned equation. This P and Q is basically V alpha I alpha plus V beta I beta. Q
sir, is equation is not visible.
Okay. Now I think you can see this.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in fact, the PQ theory, ICA star, ICB star, ICC star, using C transformation, will calculate alpha and beta component. We will use this particular expression for the generation of P and Q. So ABC voltages are converted into alpha beta. This is the transformation. You can now see this three phase quantities are converted into two phase quantities. VA, VB, VC is converted into V alpha, V beta. IA, IB, IC are converted into I alpha, I beta. Okay. And then this is the basically circuit used for generation of the reference compensating current. So this you can see P and Q are obtained from load current ILA, ILB, ILC, and source voltage VA, VB, VC. So from load current IA, IB, IC, we have derived I alpha, I beta, and then VA, VB, VC are converted into V alpha, V beta. From this, we are deriving P and Q. So that is what I was saying is ABC, we are separating active power and reactive power. And from that, we are calculating the reference active power and reference reactive power, which needs to be injected from the filter. So this is the control, is entire control scheme you can see here. This is my power circuit, three phase source, three phase load, and three phase bridge. Okay. Then we'll have this voltage sensor, source voltage sensing, as well as load current sensing. And then we are sensing the compensator current. So these six parameters, load current, source voltages, are sampled. And then using this particular block, we are simply doing mathematical calculation in terms of simple multiplier and summer, which basically will give us ICA star, ICB star, ICC star for the generation of the reference compensating current. So this file I will share you with Amrish, which you can share with all the participants, just to explain how these various components are being drawn. In fact, I also described that from where you will take the different options available. And then you can see this is the final simulation results, source voltage, and this is my load current. So you can see this is initial inrush of the current. So initially my current is non-linear here. This is the load current and source current. They are same before the compensation. Somewhere here we have started our compensator. Then moment we start the compensator, your current will become purely sinusoidal, which is exactly in phase with the voltage. This is the frequency spectrum you can see of the non-linear current. Here we can see in a three-phase case, fifth and seventh harmonics are dominating, which are visible here in this particular case. Whereas after compensation, you can see only sinusoidal current is there and will have only fundamental component. Now you see just the magnitude of fundamental component is 20.54 with a TSD of 4.16%. Whereas here my fundamental component is 19 ampere with a TSD of 26%. So you see that nonlinear load is drawing a fundamental component of 19 ampere, whereas compensated current is drawing 20.54 ampere. That means some loss component is drawn from the source, which decides the rating of the active power filter. So with this, let me go back to the presentation slide. Yeah, the next method is the frequency domain control. In case of frequency domain control, you can see source voltage, load, and APF. What we are doing here is that we are sensing the source voltage, we are sensing the load current. So using FFT, this is distorted source voltage, isn't it? If my source is distorted, that means it is having a fundamental component, then various harmonics are there. So we extract fundamental voltage, then harmonics voltage, and we using a Fourier transformation, we extract only fundamental component of the current. So later on, these are basically computed to generate the reference sinusoidal current, which is compared with the actual current for the how we extract the voltage harmonics. So this is my source voltage, and then we'll use the various FFT block available. So you can extract the fundamental voltage V1, its magnitude and angle. Third harmonic component, its magnitude and angle. Fifth harmonic component, its magnitude and angle, and so on. It's up to you how many harmonics you wish to extract. And then this harmonic component V1 A1, V3 A3, V5 A5, and fundamental component of the current, they are used to for the calculation of the reference IS star. Now you can see here, the simulation results with ideal means when my source voltage is sinusoidal. This is my load current. This current is still sinusoidal, but not in phase with the source voltage. What does indicate that I am compensating only harmonic component. No reactive VAR is being compensated here. That means the load current will become from non-sinusoidal to sinusoidal with a phase lag between source and voltage. So we are not compensating any reactive power so far. Whereas this is other phase voltage, phase A voltage, phase A current, phase B voltage, phase B current, phase C voltage, phase C current. So every case you can see both voltage and current are sinusoidal, but not in phase. Now, if we wish to, and you can see the harmonic spectrum, the load current is having 11th, 13th, no triplets will be there in a balanced three phase system. In the compensated current, only fundamental component is there. So, in fact, I missed one particular slide where we are, okay, that is, I am not having that particular slide currently. If we wish to compensate both, in that case, your source voltage will be in phase with the source current, will compensate both harmonics and reactive power compensation. This is the way how we can reduce the number of sensors. So you can see we'll sample only one voltage. That is sine wave generator, we multiplied with it a maximum value, that is the IA star. Then in this signal, we apply a 120 degree phase shifter to generate the phase B current. And if we subtract these two, we can get the third phase current. That is reference current generation using only one voltage sensor. But in that case, this is ideally not correct. These two phases are not exactly 120 degree displaced because most of our practical system are not balanced. if we use two sensors, then basically what do we do? Using phase B and phase C voltage, we can generate the phase B voltage or phase B current. So using two voltage sensor will give you a better option if there is a phase lag between any of these two voltage, that will be taken care into the third. So in fact, if you have guys any queries, we can discuss the different queries available in the mind of the participant. Any question from the audience sides, or if time permits, I can spare another 5-10 minutes. If you wish, I can show a few models on the MATLAB screen. Amrish?
Yes, sir.
If you have any query,
somebody asked
from participants,
practical example of linear and non-linear load. Means someone asked the what are the practical examples, linear and non-linear loads.
Linear, any induction motor. Induction motor is the case of a linear load, which draw sinusoidal current but lagging in nature. The current lag the voltage. There is a phase lag. Your resistive load, a lamp load, incandescent bulb. This is again a purely linear load, non-inductive, resistive, purely resistive load. Both voltage and current are in phase. Once you will add the motor, any inductance, load is still inductive, but current is lagging in nature. Your power supply. In a power supply, to maintain the constant DC output, we add a DC link capacitor there, isn't it? It becomes a non-linear load with capacitive element into the system. Any battery charger where you convert AC into DC and then put a capacitor to maintain the output voltage constant, or a motor, DC motor fed from a diode rectifier, that will become a non-linear load, which I have shown in the very beginning. This any system which draw non-sinusoidal current is considered to be non-linear. What is the current drawn by an induction motor? Current drawn by an induction motor. Any answer from the participants?
Sinusoidal current.
Sinusoidal, but lagging in nature. Isn't it?
Lagging
current by voltage. An induction motor, it is sinusoidal in nature, but it is not in phase with the source voltage. So yes, this is still a linear load, isn't it? But when we fed the motor, same motor with through a PWM converter, this is not available currently with me. Let me try to open another slide which will give you the answer of this particular question. Just a minute.
Hello, sir. Three-phase inverter fed to the induction motor can be a non-linear load?
Three-phase?
Inverter.
Mm-hmm.
If you give the output of the three-phase inverter to the induction motor.
No, just share. Let me share another screen with you. So in this particular case, you can see, let's see, this is a resistance. Okay. This is a resistance. If this resistance is fed without this diode rectifier, this is a linear load.
Yes, yes.
When I put a diode rectifier in with the same resistor, your current will be something like this. So yeah. This is non-sinusoidal. So yeah. Any resistor or inductor or a capacitor fed through any power electronic converter will become a non-linear load.
Okay, okay.
Because my voltage is sinusoidal, but current is not. Isn't it? So any load in which case current shape is different than the voltage waveform, we consider it in a non-linear case.
Okay, I would like to ask you, if suppose there is a DC motor at output and we are feeding the DC motor to the through converter, maybe AC to DC converter, thyristorize. So in that case, it will be linear or non-linear?
There is no question of its linearity now.
Yeah, yeah.
See, on this particular, this will become non-linear. A DC motor drive,
yeah.
A rectifier, adjustable frequency AC motor drive, uninterruptible power supply, arc furnaces, static var generators, cycloconverters, static motor starters, electronic lighting ballast, switching power supply. All these are the non-linear load.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Actually, I'm from electronics. That is why I ask you.
Yeah. Okay. So basically, you can see this particular case. This may be anything. This may be your DC motor.
Yeah.
Okay. When we are feeding it through a diode rectifier or a thyristorized converter, this current will be non-linear.
Yeah, yeah, got it.
Maybe this waveform or this waveform not like identical sinusoidals. So this will become non-linear.
Correct, correct. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Got it.
Anything, Amrish? Any other question?
No, sir. No, sir. No.
So, I understand. Basically, these are the topics which needs to be covered one to one. And I'm sure many of the participants might be missing. There might be several queries in their mind because the participants are from different background. Okay, so I hope very soon we'll be in this particular, overcome this pandemic and we'll be in a position to have one-to-one interaction. And probably I simply try to give an idea about the control aspect. What I will do, I'll share this tutorial sheet. You can basically conduct one tutorial session. Everything is well listed there. Which library you have to open to get a particular component, and they will be able to model this particular system.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thanks, sir.